I think if you ask any of us who worked on the hearth, to talking to victims and survivors. And the other thing this film was sort of the same thing, with you know, won an Oscar and all this stuff. It was always awkward for any of us that worked on it to get all these accolades. You know, when we won the Pulitzer Prize, when the movie comes out and all this stuff. I always felt it was really awkward because none of this gets done without the victims and survivors coming forward. And I went to the premiere of it. It first played in Boston. I actually played in Brookline, about two blocks from where John F. Kennedy was born, at the cinema there in Coolidge Corner. And I went there with Joe Crowley, who's one of the survivors in the film. And Joe and I, we didn't go. There was a big gala party after it, but Joe didn't want to go because he's been sober for about 21 years now. And so we went across to a pizzeria right across from the cinema. And I talked to him about what it had felt like to see himself up there and the whole thing. He said, it validated everything he had gone through, and he knew a lot of the other victims. And that night he met Jim Scanlon, who was the guy portrayed in the film as, you know, confirming some of the stuff that happened in Boston College High School. And to me, that's the most important thing to me for the film was not saying how great everybody at the Boston Globe was, we're just doing our jobs. The validation it had from victims and survivors was enormous. And I actually heard from some people I had not talked to in 15 years. I had not talked to them since 2002. And they had all seen the film and what it meant to them. So the power of the film is not just, I think it captured the sort of mundane stuff that newspaper reporters do every day. But I think the importance of the film, for me, having been with and talked to so many victims and survivors, is what it did for them.
And Tom, for just for Kevin's benefit and for the benefit of those who are not from the area, just remind us of the chronology, which is almost simultaneous, this of the revelations that emerged about the Ferns crisis.
Can
everyone
hear me?
Yeah.
Hear me now? That's a tough one. What I might do then is just tell a story that bookends everything about Ferns. And if I miss something, Colin will fill in the gaps. But there's a very interesting line in the movie where it says, if it takes a village to raise a child, it takes a village to abuse a child. Well, let me give you an example. In Monaguir in 1988, this principal of the school found these 10 children hanging around after class, and he asked them what the story was, and they said that in their preparation for the confirmation, they had been molested by the parish priest, who was also the chairman of the board of the school in Monaguir. So he, within hours, he brought their claims to the attention of the health board. The health board the next day came to the village to see if they could validate these claims by these 10 very brave young girls. They would tell the principal before they would tell their parents. So the health board thought that the claims could be validated. The health board got in touch with the Gardaí. This is where it gets really interesting about this notion of a village bringing up, or a community bringing up a child and then destroying them. The Gardaí then launched an investigation from an escort. Meanwhile, the chief super, who was based in Wexford, is aware of this investigation, but he's a personal friend of the bishop, Bishop Kamsky. So he sends a detective, while there's ordinary Gardaí in Monaguir, interviewing these children, and they're all girls, so they don't send a female guard, it's a male guard who does all the questioning. The chief super in Wexford sends a detective to Monaguir to tell the parish priest to take a holiday. So when it comes down to the Gardaí to interview the priest, he's missing because he's away abroad. So meanwhile, the chief super, he goes to visit the bishop, and he tells the bishop exactly where this investigation is going. So then the bishop says to chief super, more or less along these lines, will he be prosecuted? And the bishop is told, no, he won't be prosecuted. So then Father Brennan is asked to come back from holiday. He comes back from holiday. There's no prosecution. So on the day of the confirmation, the bishop accompanies the priest down to church in Monaguirre and goes up to the altar. And the two of them stand there waiting for the 10 little liars to come up and be confirmed. And at this time, we know that, this is 1988, we know that in the Dublin diocese, the church is withholding allegations from the Gardaí made against 35 priests. We know that in California, the church is withholding 600 allegations against 200 priests. We know that in Ferns, the church is withholding 100 allegations against 21 priests. We know in the early days of Boston, it's 90 priests. So then, throughout the 90s, things developed. Ministry, he doesn't get a good enough one, so they're going all around the place, but they keep ending up in Wexford. Eventually, there's a new sheriff in town, a chap by the name of Chief Inspector Noel Sullivan. He's not from Wexford, he's from Kildare. He's a different attitude. So when he finds out that the child has been abused by James Doyle, within 3 months, this priest is before the courts. He also encourages the Gardaí to go after the likes of Donald Collins, who's a principal in the local school, and he also goes after Father Sean Fortune. To go through the years, what we have then, In 95, Comiskey flees to America. Later that year, Sean Fortune and Donald Collins face charges. Comiskey comes back in 96. In 98, I'm pretty sure Collins is convicted. Fortune takes his own life in 99. Soon the Pope, made very bravely by Collins, in 2002, within a week, I think, or two, Comiskey resigns. And then we have the Ferns report, which is published in 2005, the first state report in any diocese in the world, which tells the entire world that basically the church here and people within the community protect these priests from the law. So I'm going to bookend my answer by thinking about that story in Monaguirre in 1988 when that priest got off scot-free. There's something in the Ferns report, it's a horrific story, that the new bishop in town, Bishop Eamon Walsh, He found this correspondence between this young woman who got in touch with Comiskey and said that Brennan used to come to family home for dinner and he'd have a few drinks. And when he had a few drinks, the parents would say, well, look, you know what, you can't drive home, so why don't you stay over? Now, unbelievably, the parents used to let him share the bed of their 12-year-old daughter, and she was abused. So what happened then was, when she became a young woman, she got in touch with Comiskey to tell him that the priest he'd exonerated in 88 subsequently abused her. Bishop Walsh found this very hard to believe, so what he did, he went out of his way to get in touch with the parents, and he asked the parents, is it true that you used to allow Father Brennan, who's now dead, share the bed with your daughter? And they said, we did, because if anything would have happened, she would have told us. He couldn't talk to the girl because she subsequently took her own life, I think when she's 25, 26. So that's a tragedy. It begins with Monaguirre, ends with Monaguirre, and all the main players could have done something to prevent that.
Colin, I know you've seen the film before because you were at the first screening of it in Dublin. I think you did an event with the producer, Tom McCartney. What was your reactions? This is not a drama, this is not reportage. What was your reaction when you first saw the film? Did anything surprise you?
I suppose, first of all, if you don't mind, just to follow up on a couple of things that Tom said. I mean, if we want to understand the story of Ferns, we need to go much further back. I mean, as the Ferns report identified, the first allegations of abuse against a priest that the Ferns report uncovered were in 1966, when there were allegations made against Donald Collins. It's the year I was born. He, of course, subsequently went on to leave the diocese at one point, only to be brought back and become the principal of St. Peter's College and the head of the seminary there. I actually went to it's 21 years ago in February since I went to the police and reported what had happened to me. one of the extraordinary things for me about watching this film was that at the same time that Kevin and his colleagues were working on that series, I was back here. I was back in Palfour, I was back in New Ross, I was back around this area with the BBC making some of the Pope. We didn't know what was going on in Boston, we didn't know you guys were working on that. I was saying to Noel earlier on, what's it seems bizarre now to reflect back, because it's only 14 years since all of this happened, but it was a different time. It was a time before when a story broke in Boston, it was news all over the world. When something happened, it happened instantly, you knew about it. So suing the Pope aired in March of 2002. And Boston had broken, but hadn't really broken in the way that ultimately it did, and the stories did here again too. So there's this extraordinary synchronicity for me in watching what was happening in Boston and remembering what we were doing here. And what we met here was the same as you guys met when you were trying to uncover the story of Boston. And over the years, I've tried to drill down and very objectively look at and understand a lot of the narrative, you know, almost the mythology that's built around this, because it's incredible how quickly today becomes history. And we all view it through a particular kind of lens or through some kind of strange memory process. In 2011, one of the things that we did in Amnesty was we decided it was time to look at what all of the reports into child abuse here in Ireland involving the Catholic Church revealed about the nature of Ireland, the nature of our law, the nature of our society, how power played out in Ireland. How did the power dynamic that operated at those times feed into and permit what had happened and what was revealed in Ferns, in the Murphy report in Dublin, in Cloyne, and in the Ryan report. And one of the things we really wanted to do, though, we're a human rights organization, is take almost a sociological look at this. This idea that had developed that everybody knew what was happening, all of that language around the dogs on the street knew. And what we discovered, to me, really made an awful lot of sense, and we had a really good social historian look at it. It's not true that everybody knew, but it's absolutely the case that there were very deep veins of knowledge that ran all the way through Irish society, at all levels of Irish society, about what was happening. I remember being back here when we were making Suing the Pope, and we were going after a very particular piece of old film that we wanted to get. I was there with Sarah MacDonald, and it's that piece about you need an outsider. Sarah was from New Zealand and not a Catholic, and worked for the BBC. And I met her through work that I was doing with 1 in 4 in the UK there. And over a period of about a year, she convinced me to make the film. So I came back with her, and we made it. But we were in a house not very far from here one evening to get hold of this footage that was just an interesting piece of footage for the film. And the people in the house knew why I was there, and they knew who I was, and they knew the bones of my story, that I had been abused for a number of years by Father Sean Fortune in Palfour. And I remember at one point saying to the woman in the house, "Do people know what was going on?" And her answer was, "Ah yeah, people knew. They used to joke about it. They used to say, don't bend down in front of that fellow in the churchyard." And then she said to me, "We kept our lives away." And I mean, I'm telling that story not because she was a terrible woman, she wasn't. But it says something about how such knowledge was held and what we did with it, either individually or collectively at the time. These were the things that couldn't be said. And these were the things that nobody wanted to take responsibility for. And, you know, in 2016, it's easy to hear that story and be shocked and appalled and disgusted and put it on that woman. But when the guards didn't want to look at this, when the state didn't want to look at this, when the church absolutely was determined that nobody would be allowed to look at this, it's hardly unsurprising that in small places and small villages and parishes, in our own homes, we did what we could to avoid having to face up to it too, because what were we ultimately meant to do about it? So, you know, I think that's part of the narrative that we have to understand as well. And when I watched the film, it was all of those stories. It was that background stuff, you know, the extent, the depth of knowledge, the layers and levels of, I don't mean blame now here, but responsibility that existed right across Boston society, that I think also existed right across Irish society. But child abuse is a crime that is dependent upon silence. It's silence that permits, it's silence that tolerates, and it's actually silence that gives license to offending, and that allows it to become as gratuitous, as obscene, as appalling, destructive as Spotlight revealed, and as we know happened here in our community.
I grew up in the parish next door to Balfour, and I remember, and I wrote a column about this at the time, reading your book, and you told that story of a couple, you don't name them in the book, but I think I have a picture of them in my own head, and when they told you that they knew. Because when I was a teenager, and we're roughly the same age, you knew to stay away from Sean Fortune. And we'd heard rumours of boys getting up in the middle of the night and walking back from Balfour to New Ross and stories like that. But I'd always assumed that was on some kind of teenage rumour network that never kind of gravitated to the adult world. And it wasn't until I read your book that it dawned on me, my God, that sense was out there, that word was out there in the wider community.
Well, I mean, the word wasn't just out in the wider community. I mean, for me, so I went to the guards in. When we talk about the degrees of silence that exist, or the ways in which we approach, or approached perhaps, trying to deal with the facts of what had happened. I've been living in London since 1986, and in about 1994, the best way I can describe it is that I'd finally started to stop running. And stuff started to catch up with me. And I have to do something about that thing, that stuff that happened, but I couldn't name it. My first intonation, 8 years out of Ireland, 10 years away from Wexford at that stage or more, a long time away from the Catholic Church, was to write to the bishop. It wasn't to go to the guards. It wasn't to turn to the state. It was to write to the bishop. Now, thank God, no pun intended, I didn't. It took me about 6 months, and finally it was with family support, and my dad was a big part of it, that I decided to come forward, and I went to the police. That was 21 years ago in February. Within weeks of me going to the guards, Pat Mulcahy, Detective Pat Mulcahy, fantastic detective in this case, he found another five victims who made statements. Within a month, five. Like, the question just had to be asked. And there were people wanting to find a way to talk, to name what had happened. By March, Sean Fortune had been arrested. And then all of that focus went on Brendan Comiskey, he fled the country, etc.
Was that the first time you discovered that, that Fortune had other victims? And at what stage did you discover that there were other priests? And that, you know, there's that kind of layers emerge in the film gradually, the revelation, yeah, well, policy, I mean, and system and institution rather than just person.
When I came forward, I thought it was this one bad man who happened to be a priest who did something pretty awful to me, and I was worried that it might still be happening because of things that I'd heard to other people. One of my sisters had been at a family wedding, and Sean Fortune had officiated at it, and she was concerned by his behaviour at that wedding and told me about it. And that was the thing that finally got me to decide that I had to do something about it. So when I heard there were other victims, that was shocking. And then over the next 12 months, as we began to hear suggestions that there was wider and wider knowledge, and then within about 12 months, hearing a story of how complaints had been made about him abusing a group of 12 Boy Scouts on a camping trip, and that complaints had been made to the diocese, to the church authorities, and to the Scouting Association. The Scouts barred him for life, and the church ordained him a priest, and gave him a curacy, a parish. And then to find out that in Balfour, people were so concerned, not just about his behavior with young people, but about his general behavior, that they went to both bishops, Donald Hurley and then Brendan Comiskey, and finally they went to the Papal Nuncio. And then hearing a suggestion that there was a letter from the Papal Nuncio back to people in Balfour saying, the Holy See is aware of your concerns. So in that moment you're kind of hearing, hang on, two bishops, Papal Nuncio, The Pope was aware of those concerns. And yet he remained in ministry. He remained in Balfour, and then subsequently, as everybody knows, moved on to another parish. And, you know, from everything that I understand, continued to abuse for many, many years. And that's ultimately why I took the decision that I took and launched the civil case against the diocese and then sued the Pope as well.
And at what stage in the reportage of it, Tom, does it become clear to you that this is now a systematic policy to move priests around?
Yeah, I think the best thing for me was not coming from Wexford. And I came from Bray, and the only time I'd ever seen a priest in my family was actually in 2009 when my father died. So it's just a different background. So Wexford as a microcosm of another world was intriguing to me. I was in Wexford, I'd say, 6 months as a junior reporter when I happened to be in the court for the first ever conviction of an Irish priest for abusing a child. And this is interesting. We talked earlier on the column about it. This priest is Father James Doyle, who abused the son of a financial officer who worked within the diocese. And within 3 months of his court, he pleaded guilty. The judge said to him, you know, you get a suspended sentence if you get out of the diocese. So the bishop moved him to London, where he then was a chaplain to a co-ed school from where his background. But what's interesting is when the report appeared in the newspapers, the kid he abused was attending Kennedy Park Primary School in Wexford. 17 teachers in that school wrote a letter to the local paper complaining about the coverage given to the priest. Could you imagine that kid's parents and that kid going into that school and knowing the entire staff had objected to the publicity given to that priest?
But they complained just to clarify.
They complained about the newspaper simply covering the fact of the trial.
Absolutely. They just said that the priest, I saw that letter recently, they were trying to point out that the priest had good qualities too, and maybe he was kind of fond of the drink. But we came across a lot of incidents that I thought were shocking. I mean, the reason that I called my book All the Bishop's Men, because I wanted to point out there was more than one bishop. Apparently he was just as bad. And the men weren't just priests. There was an entire community doing their best. Colin referred to a story, and it came to my head then. In 95, when the bishop fled the diocese, the media were asking the right questions. And you just reminded me that the chairman of the county council...
Okay.
Can I finish? The chairman of the county council, Councillor Murray Murphy, issued a pamphlet to encourage politicians to speak up on behalf of the bishop and his good name. And I would have seen, and I think it was posted to a lot of houses, this was signed by 6 Oireachtas members, with 5 Dáil members, 1 Oireachtas member, including 3 members of the coalition government, Minister Yates, Minister Howland, and Minister Doyle. And the whole idea of this was to put pressure on the media to back off the bishop while he was away. And also, the funny thing, when I did bring out the book, trying to explain to people that there's a lot of people within the community, I remember I did something like 14 radio interviews in Ireland. Only one radio station, the local radio station, insisted that I pre-recorded. And I did the interview, it was pre-recorded, and then when it was broadcast, they left out every priest I mentioned, they left out St. Peter's College. And I was so annoyed over this, I cornered a producer the week after, literally, physically cornered, and asked him, why you done it? And he said he didn't want to offend the families of the priests. So, what we're talking about in Wexford, to a degree, is still there. Still, there are undercurrents of that level of ignorance which allowed that abuse to take place. And you're right, some sections of the media, not all the media, some sections.
Make all the worst of them. Make a newspaper which you're part of, back to the bishop, fully, the whole way through. And when you get back to America and get the press conference, the Echo newspaper, the banner on the front page that read was, now the rich will fly, that the bishop was going to sue the complainants and going to sue the media that were reporting the complaints. The Echo newspaper, Tom Mooney, of which you were a part of at the time, supported the bishop to the head.
Can I come in
there? There's no point coming here trying to rewrite history that we live.
Actually, I'm not trying to rewrite it, but we can be specific as well. I did explain that I came into this community from the outside. Are you interested in that fact? I came here in 89. I was appointed editor in late 96. The previous editor, whom you know, and I know you're talking about, he was a strong supporter of the bishop. He was dismissed, and I took over, and we changed how we're reporting things. But again, it was because I was outside of the community that I was given the job of editor. And we also got a lot of legal letters from the bishop, 96, 97, over our coverage.
Okay, Kevin, just for a second, I mean, what struck me again watching the movie was the similarity in, firstly, the type of victims. There was this focus on vulnerable kids on, and this is an argument I still have in my own professional work about the extent to which it is often involves economic exploitation. You know, the boy for whom a pound to cut the church lawn made a big difference. You know, and the working class communities, Boston, for example, where the priest coming into the house, to use the words of the film, was like God walking in the door.
No question, and there was a class element that I noticed when we started compiling this. In the sort of, there are wealthier parishes in Boston, particularly in West Roxbury, at the time maybe parts of Rosendale, that would have been middle class, even upper middle class families, and it didn't happen. We did not find a lot of victims in upper middle class areas. That said, when you got out into the suburbs, it did not matter. In the city of Boston, it did matter where you actually lived and what your socioeconomic background was. But when you got out into the suburbs where you would have had more middle class kids, the abuse was still the same. Because what we're talking about, there were predators in these parishes, and they were being moved around. The other thing that always struck me when Matt Carroll and I started going through the after an allegation of abuse, where they would move them.
The directories. Yeah.
They would invariably move them to a seaside community. And Matt and I came to the conclusion that the bishops thought maybe the sea air would do something for them. Because there's no other conclusion that could come to. But it was remarkable. It was not like a few cases. It was almost 90% of the priests that were moved from Boston parishes were moved to seaside communities after the first allegation of abuse.
Yeah, I mean, in some ways that mirrors what happens here in Ireland. Again, when you look at, for instance, what was revealed, what we discovered in Dublin, there were very working class areas of Dublin, poor and disadvantaged communities, where there were clusters of priests who were offending and were placed. I mean, Ballyferma, for instance, parts of Crumlin, there were significant, some of the most egregious depraved offenders were placed into those communities, and they ran riot. I mean, just riot in those places. Outside of Dublin, it wasn't so much the case. And maybe it's in part because of the degree to which, perhaps in more rural communities like ours, the parish priest is, or was then at least, very much the leader of the community. So it didn't matter what class you came from. It didn't matter who you were. And there were some who were protected, perhaps, because maybe their parents had more information. And therefore, like the woman I mentioned earlier, they were kept away. But for others of us, I mean, I didn't come from a working class background. Actually, most of the people I've met who were abused by Sean Fortune, for instance, didn't. And I'm sure there's people in this room who know lots of people who were abused in that firm. That wasn't necessarily the case there. It, of course, is the case that there's always vulnerability. And there's always there's always something that the perpetrator seizes upon as the way in, as the way to get in there and get control and then exercise that.
And we all know from our different lines of work that sexual abuse happens in families, sports organizations, and genocide. But there was something, again, it's captured in the film. Apart from the institutional cover-up moving around, there's something particularly pernicious about the spiritual abuse, as he described them. I mean, these were devout families who, if something went wrong in their household, would turn to their church and their religion for comfort and succor, and yet in this instance it was the church itself that came in, and the priest exploited the fate of the family and in a sense it became the cover that let him in.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I can only really speak personally, I suppose, in some ways about that. I know that the first time that I was abused by Sean Fortune, the fact that he was a priest, I nearly lost my mind. And maybe the best way that I can explain that is that, you know, I walked out of that room stunned and terrified and frozen and trying to understand what had just happened. Because everything I knew about the world, everything I'd been told about the world from the moment that I could understand language, said that what just happened couldn't have happened. So priests were good, always good, unquestionably good. You respect them. You respect your elders, you do what you're told. Provided you're good, everything will be okay, that's the deal. Behave yourself and everything will be okay. adults hurt you if you've been bad. And suddenly, I mean, I know I was 14, almost 15, but suddenly this happens. How do I understand this? Like, either everything I've been told about the world is a lie, and I know nothing, or I have to find another way to understand what's happened. And the only way for me to understand what had happened was to somehow reframe everything so that all of that made sense. And that meant that he still had to be the good priest. He had to be good. And that meant I had to be really, really bad. This had to be my fault. Yeah. So that's what it became really quickly. And again, I mean, those who want to prey on not just children, but vulnerable adults as well, that's what they'll use. So, I mean, you know, I presented him with that. I remember saying to him, this can never happen again. You know, I went and ran downstairs to the kitchen, stood at the end of the stairs trying to work out what to do next. I wanted to call him down because I had to do something about what had happened. My father's name was Sean. That made it really difficult. I didn't know what to call him. How do I call him father after what's just happened? I can't call him Sean. That's my father's name. So I call him John. And then I did what we do. I made tea. So I made him tea and I sat him down and I said, this must never happen again. And he went, you're right, you must never do this again. And he had me, but in that moment, the world made sense again. Because if I'd done this, then that's okay, everything made sense. And that's the ultimate vulnerability, actually. It's when we buy into the idea that any class of human being, any individual is beyond reproach, beyond question. When we assign that level of absolute authority, of absolute power, of absolute goodness, when anybody becomes God, that's the moment when it goes wrong.
Yeah. I don't take no question with the audience.
I was in Wexford a few years when I'd heard about Flapper was his nickname?
Flapper, yeah.
Because he was always in a hurry or something. But he was the arrogance of him. He got involved in the media, which I didn't know at the time. He wrote the local notes for the People and for the Echo. And
presented a radio program.
He was involved in Christian Media Trust, so he's in and out of...
Do you know how he got involved in that? It was when, I think it was after the final complaint that got him moved from Balfour. It was another abuse complaint. He was sent to London for treatment. Now, the cover for him going to London for treatment was that he was going over there to take part in some media training. He worked in schools while he was over there as well. Didn't cooperate with the treatment, whatever that meant. And when he came back, he was given a role, a very prominent role, in a media organization here. He then ran journalism courses and media courses and used RTÉ in Donnybrook as the base for those courses. One of the guys who took part in the film was, as a 15-year-old, raped by him in a studio in RTÉ when he, because he wasn't coping well in school, his family were delighted when he agreed to sign up to a media course, and he was unlucky enough for it to be one of Sean Fortune's courses. So all of those things, all of those opportunities that were presented to him to build his profile, to become... I mean, at one point in the local papers here, and people will remember this who follow the story for a very, very long time, he was described as the Monsignor Horan of the Southeast. Why was he the Monsignor Horan of the Southeast? Because he had all of these community employment schemes going. Why did he have community employment schemes going? Because he was getting young fellas in to do so-called work and then taking the money that was being meant to be given to them every week and putting it in his own pocket. And nobody looked. He was the Monsignor. I mean, that's the level of... So at every opportunity where he might have been detected, where questions might have been asked, rather than ask the questions, there was a way found to avoid the questions, and he got advantage on every single occasion and built a higher and higher profile. If I had a euro for every time I met somebody who said, in positions of either authority or responsibility or in public positions around him, who said, yeah, I met him, I always knew there was something about him. Everybody always knew there was something about him after the fact. And the reality is, most people knew, if they'd only taken a look, that there was something about him at the time. And really the big question is not to focus on him, but to focus on us, and to really ask ourselves, why? Why do we allow situations to develop where we ignore the things that we need to recognize are happening in front of us? That's the big question.
Take a question here. We have a microphone, or just shout away.
Okay. I've heard Colin's story before, but it's none less shocking to actually see him on stage tell us about it. I saw that program soon, but the thing that struck me about the film, it was the list of all the people, the priests, and they were nearly all Irish names. And these Boston twice, and I loved it. But I wasn't aware that there was A, so many Catholics there, and B, so many priests, or so many. The amount of Irish names is appalling.
Kevin, you're in Boston. You're in Boston.
The 19th century and into the 20th century, 90% of priests in America were Irish born. And almost 100% of bishops were Irish. In Boston, obviously, we've only had one non-Irish. The first bishop of Boston was actually French. He was Chevres. And that's actually where I went. I went to Chevres Catholic School when I was a kid. But every successive bishop after that was Irish until they had a guy from the Azores, Cardinal Medeiros. And he pissed off everybody, the Catholics in Boston, by telling them that they should not engage in white flight to avoid busing, integration of public schools. So he didn't last. And Cardinal Wall was a kind of a hybrid in the sense of that. But if you, I did a piece for the Irish Times years ago and compared the names are almost identical. We had a Walsh, we had a Welsh. The names are sort of interchangeable, but there was always a great, I mean, there's always been a predominance of Irish priests in Boston, obviously Irish American, not as the generations moved on, they would have been second, third, fourth generation Irish. But the names, if you ever did a list of the names of priests implicated in Ireland and in Boston, you would just see there would be similarities, and it would be from, as you would say over here, every parish.
Yeah. Okay, somebody behind you? Yes. Speak, yeah, from where you are, yeah.
I came to the diocese of Burlington in the year 2000, and the report was published in 2005. I naively thought that that would be the beginning of some kind of process of reconciliation or healing or openness. But in fact, as far as I can see, there were very few immediate repercussions. The thing was out there, it was somehow acknowledged, but simultaneously denied. And I think there's a sense to which that denial continues. And I wonder whether in Boston there was ever a process that went through the parishes, one by one, or would it make sense, for instance, now to have a process here that might include the showing of a movie parish by parish?
Well, Tom, do you, this process of denial, sorry, do you think that the denial is still there? Do you think the denial is still there, the sense of denial you spoke of?
I think when you go to infirm support, there's a lot of it that doesn't make any sense. It doesn't make common sense. I mean, what always baffles me, and I scratch my head when I hear about it, there was one year in particular when there was a priest from Wisconsin, Father Lawrence Murphy, who was abusing deaf children. There was a priest in California, Father Michael Baker, who was abusing young kids. And there was a priest in Essen in Germany, Father Peter Hullerman, who was abusing kids. And there was two in Wexford, Canon Clancy and Donald Collins. And what they have in common is they were all asked by the bishop, did they have sexual relationships with these people? And they all said yes, they all admitted it. And so what the bishops did throughout the world is that they moved them from parish to parish. The one about Canon Clancy was based in Ballandagan, and the Bishop Clancy got a letter from a young girl saying that he had sexual relationships with her. Comiskey met Canon Clancy. autopsy and said to him, was this true? And he said, yeah, she was a fine looking young woman, and she was coming on to him. So his response was to move him three miles down the road to Kiltealy. With Donald Fortune, or Donald Collins, he asked him, did he have a certain relationship with a young chap? And he said yes, and his response was to send them to, as Collins said, treatment in America. They all leave Wexford, they go to Dundalk, they go to Belfast, they go to London, but they all come back to Wexford.
Can I just say something on the whole question of healing and reconciliation? I think part of the problem is that within the official church, okay, so at a very senior level within the church, that kind of healing is impossible because there's never been a proper acknowledgement of simple fact. So to this day, the Vatican, including under Pope Francis, who I respect on lots and lots of levels for many of the things that he says about social justice issues, the Vatican has never acknowledged the simple fact of the cover-up. Never, not once. Without all of these apologies, you know, I got blue in the face dealing with global media inquiries about, what do you think about the Pope's latest apology? And what the Pope would do, Benedict and others would do, is they would apologize for the awful hurt caused by the actions of some priests. I never asked the Vatican to take responsibility for what Sean Fortune did. I asked them to take responsibility for what they did. And they've never done that. You know, and the one thing I learned that actually, for me, had real value from the church, from church teaching, was that taking responsibilities for one's own actions, owning them, understanding them, facing yourself, and then reacting and responding with as much love and compassion and integrity as you can is essential if you're to move forward. So until the church at a very institutional level is prepared to do that, that won't happen. And just this year, we had the Curia, the cardinals, come out and say, again, in 2016, I mean, get your head around this. It didn't get the kind of attention that it deserved, perhaps, which says something about maybe where we all are at now, or where the church is at, or the hierarchy of the church is at. They said again that bishops have no responsibility to report priests who abuse children to the civil authorities. In 2016, the Vatican said that. However, healing has happened. I remember going back a few years ago, I was not long after the book came out, Would You Believe, asked me to do something with them. And I ended up going back to Pelfer and meeting with people in Pelfer, actually going back into that house and just having extraordinary conversations with the parish priest down there now. On every day in those conversations that we have with each other, healing happens. I mean, healing happens when we begin to acknowledge and accept and own the fracture. You know, one of the most extraordinary experiences I had when making Simon the Pope in 2001, was going to Belfast and having incredibly painful conversations with people. Incredible people. Like Monica and John Fitzpatrick, who opened up for the first time about the loss of their son, Peter, age 23, who shot himself in the chest at the age of 23. And I would never been able to acknowledge what all of that was about until that moment. Like others, some people in this room tonight who just talked honestly and openly about what had happened because they needed to. That's when healing starts to happen. And the thing that we have to stop fearing, I think, and it's not unique to this particular circumstance, the thing that we have to stop fearing is acknowledging where we're broken, because when we acknowledge where we're broken, then we can actually do something about it. And we have to trust in our capacity to do that. So I think an awful lot of healing has actually happened. I think where it doesn't, and I think it hasn't happened as fully as it needs to, is where we're still inclined to look away. And for a very long time in this county, and I know I felt it, I saw it in people's eyes when they saw me sometimes. It was like, oh crap, that's a bit uncomfortable. You know, there was a kind of a sense of either shame or discomfort about simply acknowledging what had happened. It happened. And what happened doesn't define us. But what we do when we finally begin to face what happened says something about who we are. Not who we were, but who we are. And that we can decide today and every day from this point on. And we have a huge opportunity here, I think, to really use that in a very transformative way, and I hope we do.
I'll take one last question from Amy.
It's not so much the question, Noel, is that I just want to make the point that I've known Tom a long time, and I don't think anybody could doubt his integrity. He also took a very brave stand against foreign republicanism when it was unpopular to do. And just in his story about Mona Gear, I knew a couple of people in Mona Gear who were ordinary people, not pillars of society like maybe Kevin pointed out in the film, and they firmly believed that Father Brennan did nothing wrong. And I was almost convinced because these were ordinary people that I respected. But the other part of the story, you might have just omitted, Tom, is that there was very brave people in the church that day, and they did walk out in front of the bishop. So there was a certain understanding in that community. I'd also like to say, I'm a big admirer of the compassion that Colin has shown. I think it's incredible. Right through, not only now, but he's a hero of mine, so is Tom, and I'll add Kevin to that list. The guns don't stop.
It's also a movie about journalism. What's the importance of the story?
I think one of the good things about the film, there are two things that I think I really admired in the film, that they showed that the globe fell down.
Yeah.
We could have reported this earlier. I was actually wrote a couple of stories in the 90s myself about it, and it never really picked up traction. We never really identified it. I thought that was, it admitted the failure. We were part of the society that looked the other way. We didn't challenge the authority when we had the opportunity to. But the thing I really loved about the film was recognizing how labor intensive it is to do this kind of work. And that, you know, the importance of journalism, I actually wonder, and I'm not popular with my colleagues for saying this, I wonder if the Globe would do this today. Because we spent over $1 million on litigation. We didn't get any money back. We don't have a system like you guys, when you're in the good, you generally get your fees. We don't. We spent over $1 million litigating this to get the records that really proved everything. And I don't know if we could actually do it today. It underscores the importance of daily journalism, of labor-intensive journalism. We have a lot of people on this. Like I said, the initial story was produced by four people, the four people that are portrayed in the film. And then we doubled the size of the staff and we worked on it for 2 years and produced something like 600 stories just on this. I don't even know if the Globe would do that today, because I don't know if we could marshal the resources. So we're at a very difficult point in American journalism, where the numbers are contracting. The internet has robbed us of the advertising that paid for good quality journalism. And it's sort of like what we were talking about earlier today about the way we're covering the presidential election. We have 24-hour news cycle, and a lot of it isn't news. And I think this is the kind of stuff that's very important. Brian McGorry, who's the editor of the Boston Globe right now, talks about that this is the kind of journalism, the only reason we exist is to do things like this. We have to do everything else, that we have to, you know, we have to cover what we would call mundane news and things like this, but it's the sort of the investigative stuff, going at things like this and challenging the status quo and the powers that be. This is the essence, it's the only reason we exist, and once we stop doing this, we will stop being a force and we will go away.